Chapter 10, Reminiscences of the Renowned Commander, Ardent Friendship for Grant, Interesting Facts and Anecdotes. Like all men of strong and intense American personality, General Sherman had some peculiarities that were quite his own. Akin to Grant's taciturnity was Sherman's brusqueness. He was not exactly discourteous, though none held in greater contempt the ceremonial insincerities of what is called polite life, but he had the bluntness of the soldier to excess. If anything was said that did not meet with his approval, he was quick to say so in most forcible terms, and he did not care how it was taken. Even in private life, he was the fighter, and it was this aggressiveness and pugnacity of his nature and his way of hitting out straight from the shoulder that got him into so many disputes in St. Louis about seeming trifles, and led him to finally shake the dust of the city from his feet forever. If he did not like people, he did not hesitate to tell them so, and he was very quick and decided in his likes and dislikes. Very often it took strangers some time to get accustomed to him. He was so thoroughly sincere and free from the stereotyped conventionalities. Like many another great soldier, he was forcible in his language and found strong expletives convenient to express his feelings. These usually came thick and fast whenever politics was broached, though it was the subject he did not like. He had an odd antipathy to congressmen, and as a class spoke of them in terms far from complimentary. In February 1862, Grant was assigned to the command of the new military district of West Tennessee, with limits not defined. At the same time, Sherman, who was then a brigadier general, was put in command of the district of Cairo. They had both been at West Point together, but Sherman had been graduated 3 years earlier, and up to 1862 no intimacy had existed between them. Fortune, in fact, had set them thousands of miles apart, and besides, there was a considerable difference in their worldly condition. Grant was then, as a rule, very poor, while Sherman, if not rich, was at least comfortable. Congratulating Grant. The first official intercourse of the two men who were destined to win the highest renown in the army took place during the siege of Fort Donelson, when Sherman sent troops and supplies to Grant with extraordinary rapidity. Sherman was then the senior, but he wrote to Grant, "I will do everything in my power to hurry forward your reinforcements and supplies, and if I could be of service myself, would gladly come, without making any question of rank with yourself or General Smith." There was not a particle of envy in Sherman's nature, and he never intrigued for place or position. When Donelson fell, Sherman was one of the first to congratulate General Grant on his success. "I feel under many obligations to you," wrote General Grant in reply, "for the kind terms of your letter, and hope that should an opportunity occur, you will earn for yourself that promotion which you are kind enough to say belongs to me. I care nothing for promotion so long as our arms are successful and no political appointments are made." Many years passed before the pleasant relations that existed then between the two soldiers were disclosed. The war had gone into history, but when at length the story was told, the country could understand for the first time why it was there was victory in the West and so much disaster in the East. "This," says Badeau in the military history of Ulysses S. Grant, "was the beginning of a friendship destined thereafter never to flag, to stand the test of apparent rivalry and public censure, to remain firm under trials such as few friendships were ever subjected to become warmer as often as it was sought to be interrupted, and in hours of extraordinary anxiety and responsibility and care, to afford a solace and a support that were never lacking when the need arose." Noble words from Grant. Early in 1864, General Grant was made Lieutenant General and assumed command of all the armies of the United States. Immediately on receiving this promotion, with characteristic generosity, he wrote as follows to Sherman: "While I have been eminently successful in this war, in at least gaining the confidence of the public, no one feels more than I how much of this success is due to the energy, skill, and the harmonious putting forth of that energy and skill of those whom it has been my good fortune to have occupying subordinate positions under me. There are many officers to whom these remarks are applicable to a greater or lesser degree, proportionate to their ability as soldiers. But what I want to express is my thanks to you and McPherson as the men to whom, above all others, I feel indebted for whatever I have had of success. How far your advice and suggestions have been of assistance, you know. How far your execution of whatever has been given you to do entitles you to the reward I am receiving, you cannot know as well as I do. I feel all the gratitude this letter would express, giving it the most flattering construction. The reply of General Sherman to what he well called a characteristic and more than kind letter is worth quoting in part, to show the relations which existed between these two eminent soldiers fighting in a common cause. I repeat, you do General McPherson and myself too much honor. At Belmont you manifested your traits, neither of us being near. At Donelson also you illustrated your whole character. I was not near, and General McPherson was in too subordinate a capacity to influence you. Until you had won Donelson, I confessed I was almost cowed by the terrible array of anarchical elements that presented themselves at every point. But that victory admitted the ray of light which I have followed ever since. I believe you are as brave, patriotic, and just as the great prototype Washington, as unselfish, kind-hearted, and honest as a man should be. But the chief characteristic in your nature is the simple faith in success you have always manifested, which I can liken to nothing else than the faith a Christian has in his Savior. Among General Sherman's photographs was a central group of three pictures. The middle one of these was a full-length likeness of Ulysses S. Grant standing in an easy pose, with the left hand thrust into the breast of a fatigue coat and the right deep down in the trousers pocket. To the left of this was a picture of Phil Sheridan in full uniform, and to the right was a picture of General Sherman himself, also in full uniform. He was especially fond of these pictures of Grant and Sheridan. He was wont to say that he knew of no other likeness of Grant that showed so clearly the repose of the man. It had been taken at the close of the war, when Grant was down to fighting weight, as the general expressed it, and before he had become fleshy and taken on the heavy look that appears in some of his later pictures. The picture of Sheridan had been selected by General Sheridan out of many hundreds, and on this account General Sherman preferred it to all others. He used to say that he loved these pictures because they recalled to him the men as he had known them best. These photographs were among his valuable treasures. Porter's description of Sherman. Admiral Porter got down to Memphis, where Sherman was awaiting him, in a week or 10 days, and sent word to Sherman that he would call on him. Admiral Porter, in one of his books, gives a racy account of the meeting and a good portrait of Sherman. They had never before met. Thinking, says the admiral, that Sherman would be dressed in full feather, I put on my uniform coat, the splendor of which rivaled that of a drum major. Sherman, hearing that I was indifferent to appearances and generally dressed in working clothes, thought he would not annoy me by fixing up, and so he kept on his blue flannel suit, and we met, both a little surprised at the appearance of the other. "Hello, Porter," said the general. "I am glad to see you. You got here sooner than I expected, but we'll get off tonight." They were preparing for the second attack on Vicksburg. "Devilish cold, isn't it? Sit down and warm up." And he stirred up the coal in the grate. "Here, Captain," to one of his aides, "tell General Blair to get his men on board at once. Tell the quartermaster to report as soon as he has 600,000 rations embarked. Here, Dick," to his servant, "put me up some shirts and underclothes in a bag, and don't bother me with a trunk and traps enough for a regiment. Here, Captain," to another side, "tell the steamboat captains to have steam up at 6 o'clock and to lay in plenty of fuel, for I'm not going to stop every few hours to cut wood. Tell the officer in charge of embarkation to allow no picking and choosing of boats. The generals in command must take what is given them. There, that will do. Glad to see you, Porter. How's Grant?" Could not perform impossibilities. The embarkation took place December 19th, the boats steaming down to Helena. The failures of that expedition is a matter of history. The obstacles and mishaps were too great for even Sherman to overcome, and he retired, surrendering the command to McClelland, who had been personally appointed by President Lincoln. "My relief on the heels of a failure," says Sherman, "raised the usual cry at the North of repulse, failure, and bungling. There was no bungling on my part, for I never worked harder or with more intensity of purpose in my life, and General Grant, long after, in his report of the operations of the siege of Vicksburg, gave us all full credit for the skill of the movement and described the almost impregnable nature of the ground. And, although in my official reports I assumed the whole responsibility, I have ever felt that had General Morgan promptly and skillfully sustained the lead of Frank Blair's brigade on that day, we should have broken the rebel line and effected a lodgment on the hills behind Vicksburg." Sherman's wonderful faculty for comprehending topographical details, developed, of course, by his war experience, often astonished those with whom he was well acquainted. He would go for a drive where he had never been before, and startle those around him by telling them where this and that road started, the length of a stream, what was planted before growth appeared, and even telling what would be encountered ahead that was not in sight. All this he did by his keen observation, his wonderful intuition and reasoning powers, and the experience he had given to such matters for a lifetime. He said himself once, in speaking of his march to the sea, that he already knew before he started some of the states better than anybody who lives in them. Living over old campaigns. General Sherman's house was a war office in miniature. In his basement he had a big office fitted up with war maps and documents of tremendous value, including duplicates of those in use at Washington. Here he passed many happy hours, living over the old campaigns with the maps before his eyes, and planning how he might have done otherwise if he had it all to do over again, and what the result of this or that movement would have been. The office was a rendezvous for military men when they were in New York, who always were certain of meeting with a warm welcome, and it was much more frequented by historical writers in search of material and documentary evidence. A friend, in speaking of the general, said, "The old fighter is peculiar in one respect. The girl that opens his door for visitors never has to go and ask him if he is in. At the first she tells one that the general is in or he is not. That settles it. If he is in, he will see you. If you are a bore, as a good many of his callers are, look out for squalls, and under any circumstances it is not well to be prolix. General Sherman likes one to get to the point at once. If the visitor is not able to do this, he is likely to be interrupted. There is one sort of a caller who is always received with warmth, and that is one of General Sherman's old soldiers, or his boys, as he calls them. Just how much assistance General Sherman gives to old and unfortunate soldiers, it would be hard to say. No one but himself knows, and he won't tell. But these are among the more numerous of the visitors at his house. Besides them, there are all sorts and conditions of callers at his house." The California Drummer. General Sherman had a wonderful memory. This was illustrated by an incident that occurred in Philadelphia. He was visiting his daughter, and while sitting at the open window smoking one midsummer night, he saw the policeman pass, and as the patrolman halted a moment, the general was noticed to give him a keen glance and utter an exclamation. The next evening he told someone that when the policeman on the beat passed again, to say he wanted to speak to him. When the officer entered, he straightened up and gave General Sherman the regular military salute. "Aha," said the general, "I thought so. Now where was it I saw you before? Do you know me?" "Oh, yes," said the bearded patrolman. "I knew you when you were a lieutenant. I was your drummer in California." "Ha, ha, I thought so. And wait a bit. So you were that little drummer boy, and your name's Hutchinson?" Sure enough, the general of the United States Army, who had seen thousands of drummers, had recognized in a passing policeman the drummer boy who was with his company in the Mexican War. Dates, names, figures, and the greatest intricacy of details could not escape General Sherman's marvelous memory. He remembered them all, and could call them up after the lapse of many years. He remembered everything about California just before and at the time it was admitted to the Union as though it had been yesterday, He was in command of a portion of the United States forces there at that time. Sherman's humorous side. The men who served with or under General Sherman in any of his numerous and brilliant campaigns are now telling anecdotes illustrative of that wonderful personality that has made so deep an impress upon American history during the third of a century past. It was in the presence of his old army friends, when the civilian world was shut out, that he was at his best, and the flow of his spirits ran unchecked, and joke and story ran into each other, sometimes at the expense of his neighbor, and as often at the expense of himself. No conceit gave him more amusement than that his friend General Howard was a convivial spirit, given to the bowl and kindred pursuits, whereas the hero of the one arm is the most temperate of men. It was this fact that gave point to the joke, and Sherman was never more happy than when he could corner Howard at one of their little Loyal Legion dinners and lecture him upon the errors of his ways. That Seidlitz Powder. Perhaps Sherman never forgot a great practical joke which Howard unconsciously played upon him back in the days when the Union Army was resting upon its arms at Goldsboro. Sherman paid a visit to Howard's tent, where neither wine nor anything more invigorating than cold water was kept. As luck would have it, Dr. James Moore, the medical director, dropped into Howard's tent. Here was a man Sherman could depend upon in an emergency like this. Sherman gave Moore a wink when Howard's back was turned and said, "Doctor, have you a Seidlitz powder in your quarters? I don't feel just right, and I know one would do me good." Moore had not supplemented a liberal college education by several years in the Army in vain. He was equal to any drug clerk of New York in his knowledge of the meaning of a wink. "A Seidlitz powder, General?" "Certainly. Come right over to my quarters, and I can fix you out immediately." General Howard sprang to his feet. "That won't be necessary, Doctor," said he. "I have plenty of powders here, and good ones, too. I will get the general one." Sherman had little desire and less need for a Seidlitz just then, and he followed Howard to his feet. "Never mind," said he, "I can get along very well without it." "No trouble at all," Howard answered, as he began to get the powder and the glasses ready. Sherman turned to Moore for relief, but that gentleman was busy in examining the landscape as an aid to keeping his face straight. When that was accomplished, he turned about and gravely said, "By the way, General, I don't believe I have one about the premises, and you had better take the one Howard has prepared." Moore was something of a joker himself, and knew a joke when he saw one. Sherman was a soldier to the backbone and would not retreat in the face of an enemy. When Howard came up with the glasses, he bravely took them and swallowed the foaming stuff. But he never again complained of needing medicine when in Howard's tent. A joke on the General. A joke as good, but of a different character, was that almost unconsciously perpetuated on Sherman by an Indian chief. Out at Fort Bayard, there lay for a long time an old cannon of no use to anyone, but which had greatly taken the fancy of an old Apache chief. He daily asked the commander for it, but was put off with the excuse that it belonged to the government and could not be given away. One day, General Sherman arrived at the fort, and the request of the chief was referred to him. He examined the cannon, saw that it was worthless, and told the Indian he might have it. Then, putting on a grave air, he said to the chief, "I am afraid you want that gun so that you can turn it on my soldiers and kill them." "Umph! No!" was the unexpected reply. "Cannon kill cowboys. Kill soldiers with club." General Hickenlooper of Ohio tells a story illustrating Sherman's dry wit, rather at the expense of general course. In the fight at Altoona, a rifle ball took course alongside the head, making a slight wound that, at the time, was thought to be a great deal more dangerous than it really was. When the word reached Sherman, it had been greatly magnified, and he was informed that course's ear and cheek were gone, but that he would still hold his position and fight it out. Meanwhile, course had tied up his head and gone on with the business he had been sent there to do. As soon as possible, Sherman hurried over, full of anxiety as to the amount of damage done his officer. Nothing would do but that the bandage must come off, so that he might judge of the damage for himself. The surgeon carefully took off the clothes and revealed a slight gash across the face and a hole through the ear. Sherman looked for a moment, and then dryly said, "Why, of course, they came mighty near missing you, didn't they?" Going just where I please. Many are the stories told of that march to the sea, and occasionally the general would tell one himself. Here is one of his own narration. On one occasion he had halted for rest on the piazza of a house by the roadside, when it came into the mind of an old Confederate who was present that he might pick up a bit of valuable information by a little careful quizzing. He knew by Sherman's dress that he was an officer, but had no suspicion as to his rank. When he heard a staff officer use the title of General, he turned to Sherman in surprise and said, "Are you a general?" "Yes, sir," was the response.
"What is your name?"
"Sherman."
"Sherman? You don't mean General Sherman."
"That's who I mean."
"How many men have you got?"
"Oh, over 1,000,000.
"Well, General, there's just one question I'd like to ask, if you have no objection."
"Go ahead."
"Where are you uns a-goin' to go when you go away from here?"
"Well, that's a pretty stiff question to ask an entire stranger under these circumstances, but if you will give me your word to keep it a secret, I don't mind telling you."
"I'll keep it a secret. Don't have no fear of me."
"But there is a great risk, you know. What if I should tell you my plans, and they should get over to the enemy?"
"I tell you there is no fear of me."
"You are quite sure I can trust you?"
"As your own brother."
The general slowly climbed into his saddle and leaned over to the expectant Confederate, who was all eyes and ears for the precious information. "I will tell you where I am going. I am going just where I please." And he did, and there was not enough power in the South to stop him. The Brave Drummer Boy. Sherman never forgot that little drummer boy who came to him in the hot fight at the rear of Vicksburg. And when it came in his power, he had the youngster appointed to the Naval Academy at Annapolis. The troops were in the heat of the engagement when Sherman heard a shrill, childish voice calling out to him that one of the regiments was out of ammunition, and that the men would have to abandon their position unless he sent to their relief. He looked down, and there by the side of his horse was a mite of a boy with blood running from a wound in his leg.
"All right, my boy," said the general. "I'll send them all they need, but as you seem to be badly hurt, you had better go and find a surgeon and let him fix you up."
The boy saluted and started to the rear, while Sherman prepared to give the required order for the needed ammunition. But he once more heard the piping voice shouting back at him,
"General! Caliber 58! Caliber 58!"
Glancing back, he saw the little fellow, all unconscious of his wound, running again toward him to tell of the character of the ammunition needed, as another size would have been of no use and left the men as badly off as before. Sherman never could speak too highly of the little fellow's pluck. He asked him his name, complimented him, and promised to keep an eye upon him, which he did. He often related the story, and always with praises for the little soldier's bravery. A good story is told of one who was on Kennesaw Mountain during Sherman's advance. A group of Confederates lay in the shade of a tree overlooking the Union camps about Big Shanty. One soldier remarked to his fellows,
"Well, the Yanks will have to get up and get now, for I heard General Johnston himself say that General Wheeler had blown up the tunnel near Dalton, and that the Yanks would have to retreat because they could get no more rations."
"Oh," said a listener, "don't you know that old Sherman carries a duplicate tunnel along?" One day, looking back, the men saw a line of bridges in their rear in flames.
"Guess, Charlie," said a trooper. "Uncle Billy has set the river on fire."
Charlie's reply was, "Well, if he has, I reckon it's all right." A capital host. General Sherman was always a most delightful host. His welcome was cordial and hospitable, and the guests felt at once at ease while realizing the honor and the privilege of the association. As a raconteur, he was admirable. He had lived so long, had seen so much, and had done so much, that the least suggestion brought forth from him stories that were both instructive and entertaining.
On his 70th birthday, which he celebrated by a little dinner in his home on the evening of February the 8th, 1890, he said, "Yes, I am 70 years old today. The time allotted for man to live, but I can truly say that I have not felt better at any time within 10 years. 70 years is a long time, and it seems a great while since I was a boy. Still, I can recall incidents that happened when I was not more than 4 years of age." His memory was astonishing in detail, and his mind was wonderful in vigor. He could recall the minutiae of incidents almost from infancy and throughout his eventful career. The partiality of the grizzled old war hero for ladies' society is well known, and at school reunions and many such occasions, his friendly and cordial notice of many a rosy miss who had never seen him before is familiarly remembered. His love for the theater was prodigious. He was deeply interested in all that pertained to the stage, and he valued certain actors and actresses as his dearest friends. He used to tell how he had come to New York when he was 16 years old, and had then visited the Old Park Theater on Park Row, between Beekman and Ann Streets. In those days, he said, there were great star actors, but the general average of theatrical people was not high, and the possibility of an actress being received in social circles was not considered. He gloried in the change that had taken place in the interim, and it was a delight to him to recognize the fact that many of our actresses today might grace any parlor with their presence. He maintained that it was the duty of all public men to foster and encourage an institution so worthy as the stage. Opinion of dinners. In attending public dinners, of which he averaged far more than any other man of his age, General Sherman was very particular as to what he ate. He confined himself on such occasions to the plainest dishes, and was wont to drink only a little sauterne or sherry. He never touched champagne, and had no use for the heavier wines. Of all things, he abhorred what he called those mixed-up French dishes which might be anything or nothing. "Half the time," he used to say, "these concoctions are only turkey or chicken hash fixed up with some kind of sauce and called a croquette or something of the kind. I have no use for them." He had his own theories about dining both in private and in public. He disliked exceedingly the prevalent custom of late dinners. He declared that all private dinners should be given at such an hour as to enable the diners to attend the theater afterward. His great love for the theater probably had more to do with this position than his dislike for late dinners. He also advocated plain food for public dinners and deplored the costliness of modern banquets, declaring that it was absurd to pay $25 a plate for a dinner. Most people could not eat such dinners, and those that could paid the penalty of sickness for their rashness. Fond as General Sherman was of public banquets, he loved his home better. He was happiest when he could gather about him a choice circle of intimate friends and entertain them in his own house. Birthday episode. When he attained his 70th birthday, the Union League Club proposed to honor the event by a banquet to him in its clubhouse. He thanked them for the kindness intended, but refused on the ground that he had arranged and preferred a little dinner in his own dining room, which could seat but 16 people. And so he told the members of the Union League that they would have to postpone their proposed banquet or else abandon it altogether. He was going to dine at home that night, and with him he would have his brother John, the United States Senator from Ohio, and General Schofield, General Howard, and General Slocum, who had been with his 3 division commanders at the close of the war. It afforded General Sherman the greatest happiness that these 3 distinguished soldiers should be with him that night, and all in excellent health. Mr. Depew was very anxious to have General Sherman come around to the Union League Club that night after the dinner in his own house, but the general replied to this suggestion, "How can I do that, Chauncey? I can't hurry up my guests in order to go to somebody else's entertainment. You will have to give up this Union League scheme of yours." And so Mr. Depew submitted gracefully to the inevitable, but a month later a grand banquet was given by the Union League in honor of General Sherman's birthday, and at this banquet were present many of the most noted men in the United States, all eager to honor the old chieftain. The General's Fad. Thousands of his friends have interesting stories to tell of Sherman. So democratic were his manners, and so easy for all sincere travelers was the road to his heart, that of his friends and admirers, numerous as they were, each feel as if they had in his particular custody some bit of history or anecdote of the great commander, which the world could not afford to lose. The general's fondness for kissing pretty girls was the subject for stories innumerable. How that fondness, which may have been latent in his earlier career, for all we know, developed with him into a fad in the satisfaction of which his efforts were untiring, and, it must be confessed, exceedingly popular. Here are the facts as related by himself. Some time after Grant was elected president, I went to call on him at the White House. I had been struck with the number and speed of his horses, and with the delight it seemed to give him to be in their company. So I said to him, "General, fine horses seem to have become a fad with you." "Well, Sherman," said he, "we all must have our fads these days. It seems to have become the fashionable thing. I have all my life been intensely fond of good horse flesh. In my youth I didn't have the means to indulge in this fancy. Later in life I had not the time. Now, when for the first time I have both the money and the leisure, I am indulging in it and enjoying it to the full." Kissing the Pretty Girls. "Well, General," said I suppose I'll have to be getting a fad myself. I never have had one, and if I have one now, I don't know it. Let me see, what shall it be? I have it. You may drive your fast horses, and I will kiss all the pretty girls. Ha! That shall be my fad." General Sherman was some years afterward a guest at Congress Hall, Saratoga, where a well-known lady was a conspicuous figure with her diamonds and her costumes. Not the least interesting of her possessions was a very charming daughter about 15 years of age, just blushing into the first beauty of maidenhood, and as plump and as fascinating a little creature as the eye might light upon in a long day. There was a children's ball that evening at Congress Hall, and General Sherman, who seemed to be in an excellent humor, strolled into the ballroom about the time the music struck up, in company with the wife of the gentleman who is the authority for these incidents. Rebuffed by a little maid. There were scores and scores of pretty young misses ranged around the walls and waiting for the dance, as General Sherman, on the arm of his fair companion, promenaded past this array of juvenile pulchritude. A smile of unmistakable satisfaction came to his face, and his eye wandered from one bud to another with intense and respectful appreciation. When he reached the young lady referred to, after having bestowed a series of rattling salutations on the most attractive little maids, he interrupted his triumphal progress and reached out his arms to salute her tempting lips, but she would have none of it. "Thank you, sir," she said with a profound courtesy. "I cannot kiss anyone without my mother's permission." The general was delighted. "My dear young friend," he said with a cordial laugh, "you are quite right. But allow me to say that I must insist upon your continuing to keep this excellent rule of conduct. Promise me now that never, as long as you live, will you kiss any man who is not specially designated and approved by your mother." Whether she did or did not make the promise is not a matter of history, but the incident was an exceedingly diverting one to all who witnessed it. Florida Experiences. General Sherman and General Carleton, the father of Henry Guy Carleton, were lieutenants together in the army under General Harney, the famous Indian fighter, down in the Seminole War. General Sherman's experiences at that time in Florida were a fruitful source of anecdote in his afterlife. One story in particular he told with great gusto of an interview between himself and a very respectable-looking young white man, taken prisoner by the troops from the ranks of Billy Bowleg's disreputable followers. He said it showed how accident made or marred a career. "I said to this young man," General Sherman used to say, "that it was difficult for me to understand how he got into such bad company. 'Lieutenant,' said he, 'I am here as the victim of one of the most unfortunate accidents that ever happened. My father and mother are excellent citizens of the state of Kentucky, where on the farm near Paris I spent a happy boyhood. The bright dreams of my youth were clouded over by an untoward encounter with a jackass. That whole region in which we live was infested by those half-wild jacks, which had been imported into the state by thousands. Kentucky was the great mule producer among the states, and when the old discarded jacks were turned out worthless, we boys used to lasso them and ride them out into the woods on our expeditions after chestnuts and walnuts. One day I secured the raggedest, longest-eared, and deepest-voiced brute you ever saw, and hid him in the smokehouse, intending to start off before day the next morning on a nutting expedition. Now, I had a maiden aunt who lived in the family who had a strong and earnest conviction of the existence of a personal devil. The evil one was to her just such an awful creature as Bunyan showed his to be in his Pilgrim's Progress. Down on a farm in Kentucky, people get up before day, anyway, and when my aunt went out to the smokehouse the next morning to get some bacon to fry for breakfast, it was still pitch dark. His Satanic Majesty. As she opened the smokehouse door, she said afterward she saw the horrible face of the arch-enemy himself popped suddenly out at her through the darkness, set off by two long and hideous horns. No sooner had the jack spied my respected relative than he broke forth into a series of the most diabolic, ear-piercing, nerve-tearing hee-haws that ever desolated the stillness of a country landscape. My aunt went off into a succession of fits, and when she came to, she swore by all that was holy that she had seen the devil. I had slept calmly through the whole disturbance, but the offense was promptly laid at my door, and, entering my room while I was yet asleep, my father wore out a leather strap on me. But for this apparently trivial incident, I might today be a respected citizen of the great state which raises pretty girls, bluegrass, mules, and bourbon. For smarting under a sense of wrong and the lively application of the strap, I put two shirts into a handkerchief, and without waiting to say goodbye, made a beeline south. I never stopped until I got into the Florida swamps, where I have just been taken prisoner. Old Bill. This was a favorite story of General Sherman's, as showing how a man's whole career could be swerved by a trifling incident. There is another story which he used to tell to his intimates which illustrates the serious side of his mind, and betrays by a touch the gentle and affectionate nature which became toward the end of his life his most marked characteristic. "When I went back to Washington," he used to say, "after the war was over and took part in the Grand Review, I was struck during the first day by the disorder and confusion in the procession caused by the antics of some of the fiery chargers ridden by the officers. On the first day the Army of the Potomac filled by. Many gallant troopers had changed off their old war horses, and that day for the first time rode animals unaccustomed to such surroundings. The immense masses of humanity, the blare of the bands, and the glitter of the landscape in general frightened these beasts, so that they interfered seriously with the general effect of the spectacle. The morning of the next day, when the Army of the Tennessee was to march by in review, my old body servant came to me and said, 'General, what horse do you want to ride today?' 'Old Bill,' said I. 'Why, General,' said my servant, 'Old Bill isn't the kind of horse you'd want to ride today, sure. Why, he's got no life and spirit about him, and won't make any show at all.' 'Now,' continued the general, 'that was the very reason why I wanted to ride Old Bill. I knew there was no nonsense in him. In fact, he might have been called sheepish. A cannonade itself would not have excited him, and I was looking out for my own comfort, not for display. So that morning I got on the old charger and rode quietly along through that impressive scene. The old fellow never phased and exhibited about as much style as a plow horse. But we got through very comfortably. After passing about 100 yards beyond the grand stand, I rode Old Bill to the sidewalk and dismounted. He was led away, where I do not know, and I have never seen the old fellow since. I never knew what they did with him, and it has always been a genuine sorrow to me that I hadn't been able to keep him near me during the rest of our lives." His versatility.
Colonel L.M. Dayton, who came on from Cincinnati to attend General Sherman's funeral, was 8 years on his staff, serving with him during the entire war and for nearly 5 years afterward. The intimacy of the relations which Colonel Dayton in such a position necessarily sustained to the great commander gave him a peculiar insight into the operations of his mind. He tells the following story of an incident which could have happened in the military experience of no other general during the war, and which illustrates admirably the boldness of Sherman's military operations and the extraordinary foresight with which he planned out a campaign even beyond what might seem to many its objective point. "What amazed me most," said Colonel Dayton, "was the versatility of that extraordinary soldier. I cannot help but believe that as a general he was greater than any other the war produced. He planned a campaign to its uttermost limit before he began active operations. For instance, in the Vicksburg campaign, while General Grant might not have figured out his movements beyond the actual capture of that city itself, General Sherman, in his place, would have outlined clearly what he would do with his men after the siege and what disposition he would make of the baggage and siege guns. When we started out from Atlanta on the march to the sea, nobody knew what our objective point on the Atlantic coast was, except a few members of the staff and the authorities at Washington. Everybody else simply knew that we were going to march across Georgia to the coast. When General Sherman reached Savannah, which of course was all along known to the authorities as our objective point, he was greatly surprised to find out that a gunboat had been dispatched down the coast to meet him there. I won't do anything of the kind. The captain of this gunboat had succeeded in ascending Assabau Sound and the Ogeechee River, which lies just back of Savannah, and made instant communication with the general. An important official document which had been brought down in this way was handed to General Sherman in my presence. When he received it, he got excited and seemed vexed about something. I noticed his color rising and a look of irritation in his eye, as well as the nervous motion of the left arm which characterized him when anything annoyed him. It seemed, for instance, as if he was pushing something away from him. "Come here, Dayton," said he, and we went into the inner room of the building where he made his headquarters. As soon as we got inside, I could see that he was greatly opposed to the suggestions that had apparently been contained in the document. "I won't do it," he would say to himself several times over. "I won't do anything of the kind." The document was an official order from Secretary Stanton, approved by General Grant, for General Sherman to wait with his army at Savannah for transports which had been sent down to the coast to convey them by sea to the mouth of the James, and then to ascend that river to cooperate with Grant. General Sherman had all along intended to march his army up the coast across the country, and he sat down at once and wrote a letter to General Grant explaining to him why he was opposed to taking a sea voyage with his men, how he thought such an experience would demoralize them with seasickness, confinement in close quarters, and lack of exercise, and how he had decided to take all the responsibility and march them up by land in accordance with his original plans. He said he would be at Goldsboro, North Carolina, on the 21st day of March, 1865, and that if any other orders were sent to him there, they would reach him promptly. So closely did he calculate that on the 23rd of March he was in possession of Goldsboro. As Sherman had at that time practically an army of 100,000 men, which could easily annihilate any opposition he might meet with on his march, the wisdom of his course was at once apparent to the authorities, and no attempt was made to interfere with his execution of his plans. As a matter of fact, he did encounter Joe Johnston on the way up the coast, and defeated him at Bentonville. That, I believe, was his last battle. No other general would have dared to do what Sherman did in this instance. The boldness of his military genius and his keen insight into the future were admirably illustrated by it. How he met Jenny Lind. "It was in Florence," he said. "I received a card to a musicale, as they called it,
and Jenny Lind sent me with this card a note saying how much she would feel honored and all that. So I went. Lord, but it was awful. They lived on the top floor of an old palace. Jenny Lind looked like a washwoman, and Goldschmidt, her husband, was a little black weazened fellow. There was a daughter, too, I remember. She was freckled mighty bad. It was an awful time. The refreshments were ice cream and jumbles. I got away as soon as I could. It made my heart ache to remember that woman so different, and see her now so contented with the change. I'd have jumped out of a four-story window to have escaped. She was a good woman, too, he went on musingly. They were very poor at this time. She had spent all the money she had made in America in Swedish charities. I think she might better have kept some of it, anyhow. Hated to be photographed. My, how I hate to be photographed, the general exclaimed one day, because in pictures, by that process, I always look stern. I don't like to look stern. My mood is pleasant and friendly to all, though I have been told that when I'm in a fight, I look like the very devil. That is because my nature is one that concentrates itself, heart and soul, fire and will, into one terrible focus. No half measures for me. I take after my mother in that. He tells of a speech by Grant. The following characteristic anecdote of General Grant was told, and illustrated with exquisite humor, by General Sherman at a little dinner. Grant and I were at Nashville, Tennessee, after the Battle of Chattanooga. Our quarters were in the same building. One day, Grant came into the room that I used for an office. I was very busy, surrounded with papers, muster rolls, plans, specifications, etc., etc. When I looked up from my work, I saw he seemed a good deal bothered, and after standing around a while, with his shoulders thrown up and his hands deep in his trousers pocket, he said, "Look here! There are some men here from Galena." "Well," I said. Looking more uncomfortable every minute, he went on. "They've got a sword they want to give me." And looking over his shoulder and jerking his thumb in the same direction, he added, "Will you come in?" He looked quite frightened at the idea of going to face them alone, so I put some weights on my several piles of papers to keep them from blowing around, and went into the next room, followed by Grant, who by this time looked as he might if he'd been going to be court-martialed. There we found the mayor and some members of the board of councilmen of Galena. On a table in the middle of the room was a handsome rosewood box containing a magnificent gold-hilted sword, with all the appointments equally splendid. Grant nonplussed. The mayor stepped forward and delivered what was evidently a carefully prepared speech, setting forth that the citizens of Galena had sent him to present to General Grant the accompanying sword, not as a testimonial to his greatness as a soldier, but as a slight proof of their love and esteem for him as a man, and their pride in him as a fellow citizen. After delivering the speech, the mayor produced a large parchment scroll, to which was attached by a long blue ribbon a red seal as big as a pancake, and on which was inscribed a set of complimentary resolutions. These he proceeded to read to us, not omitting a single whereas or hereunto, and after finishing the reading, he rolled it up and with great solemnity and ceremony handed it to Grant. General Grant took it, looked ruefully at it, and held it as if it burnt him. Mrs. Grant, who had been standing beside her husband, quietly took it from him, and there was dead silence for several minutes. Then Grant, sinking his head lower on his chest and hunching his shoulders up higher and looking thoroughly miserable, began hunting in his pockets, diving first in one and then in another, and at last said, "Gentlemen, I knew you were coming here to give me this sword, and so I prepared a short speech," and with a look of relief he drew from his trousers pocket a crooked, crumpled piece of paper and handed it to the mayor of Galena, adding, "And, gentlemen, here it is." The General and Mrs. Cleveland. To those who appreciated General Sherman's genial nature, it is superfluous to say that he regarded his extensive acquaintance with the ladies of the White House with peculiar gratification. This he specially referred to on one occasion when he had been introduced to Mrs. Cleveland, then but a short time a bride. The general said, The other day, when I was in Washington, I received a note from Mrs. Endicott telling me that the President and Mrs. Cleveland were to dine at her house that evening, and begging me to join them. I wrote her a very polite reply, said I had two or three engagements I must keep, but if Mrs. Endicott would reserve me a place, I would slip in quietly and take up my dinner at the point at which I arrived. When I got there, they were at the table, and I found that the seat at Mr. Endicott's left had been reserved for me, Mrs. Cleveland being on his right. Well, we just shoved Endicott to one side and sailed in and had a good time. After a while, the ladies left us, and then after a little, we went into Endicott's room for a smoke. Then, about 11:30, we went up to the ladies. It was rather late, and very soon Mrs. Cleveland made a move to go, and of course several gentlemen surrounded her, helping her with her wraps, and she turned to me and said very quietly, "General, I am very glad to have met you, and I want you to come and see me." I smiled and said, "You know that such an invitation is a command." And she smiled back and said, "When will you come? Tomorrow? Shall we say 1 o'clock? Well, I went, and she came in to meet me plainly and simply dressed, and was just sweet and girlish, but bright and shrewd. The finest lady at the White House. She wanted to know all about the ladies that have presided in the White House. I have known 'em all since Jackson's time, and she made me tell her about them. I consider Harriet Lane, Buchanan's niece, the finest lady that ever did the honors of the White House, though she was cold and impassive. But her tact and suavity of manner were perfect. I believe Mrs. Cleveland has taken Harriet Lane for her model, and she is as clever and sweet a lady as Miss Lane was. The sweetest woman I ever met presiding there was Kitty Taylor, General Taylor's daughter, afterward Mrs. Dr. Dandridge. But none of them was brighter and more beautiful than Mrs. Cleveland. Youth and beauty General Sherman loved. Indeed, I think the only subject on which I ever heard him speak with deep regret, says a friend, was that of lost youth. One day he remarked, "Ah, how I envy the young, their hopes and dreams and aspirations. I envy the beggar on the street if he is young. Who can tell what lies before him?" Yes, yes, I know, but there's no fun in looking back. It's an old story. You've heard it over and over again, but the future may hold all sorts of surprises. I went into my club the other night, and a young fellow came over to me and said, "General, I am very proud and happy to meet you. You've been a landmark to me all my life. I've read about you in history." Lord! He looked at me with reverence and bowed down before me, and it was all I could do to be civil to him. Read about me in history, indeed, as if I were Moses! At the time of the death of General Sheridan, he was lamenting the rapid thinning of the ranks of his contemporaries, and, shaking his head, said sadly, "There we go, one after another. Grant and Sheridan, and soon, I suppose, I shall join the procession. Well, that will be the last of the race. There will be no generals left when I'm gone." Excuses for swearing. On one occasion, when visiting his sister, Mrs. Ewing, General Sherman met 4 or 5 clergymen, and his patience was rather severely tried by their religious discussions and what seemed to him their intolerant and one-sided views. One of them challenged him to offer any excuse for swearing, meeting him with the clinching statement that there could be no redemption for blasphemers. "Were you," inquired the young soldier, "ever at sea in a heavy gale, with spars creaking and sails flapping, and the crew cowardly and incompetent?" "No." "Did you ever," he continued gravely, "try to drive a 5-team ox cart across the prairie?" "No." "Then," said Captain Sherman, "you know nothing of temptations to blasphemy. You know nothing about extenuating circumstances for blasphemers. You are not competent to judge." Proud of his mother. General Sherman was proud of tracing his powers of endurance to his mother, to whom he also frequently ascribed the heritage of other soldierly characteristics. "She married very young," said the general, her husband, who was not very much older, being a lawyer with hope and ambition for his patrimony and all the world before him where to choose, he chose Ohio, leaving his young wife in Jersey City while he made a home for her in what was then a far country, though now comparatively near. Soon as he made a home for her, she went to him. She rode on horseback, with her young baby in her arms, from Jersey City to Ohio, the journey occupying 23 days. What would a New York bride say to such a journey as that? I'm afraid she'd have to wait until her husband had made money enough to have a railroad built for her. General Sherman's idolized soldier boy. Willie Sherman, when about 9 years of age, went down to Mississippi, where he became a comrade and favorite of the 13th Regulars, who formed General Sherman's personal escort. On the way up the river, after the Vicksburg campaign, he became ill. October the 3rd, 1863, the brave little fellow died. October the 4th, he had a military funeral at Memphis. At midnight came a letter of thanks from the general to Captain Smith, commanding battalion, one of the most touching letters ever written. In the spring of 1867, the body was removed to St. Louis and buried in Cavalry Cemetery. A beautiful marble monument was erected by the officers and soldiers of the battalion. The above facts suggested the following poem, a copy of which was sent to the general at his home in New York. In the battalion, the boy was fondly called Sergeant Willie. The 13th Regulars as brave, a regiment as ever gave, their blood to soldier sundered lands, of prompt obedience to commands. Had once a sergeant of the line, a little fellow aged 9, called Sergeant Willie, Sherman's boy, his father's pride, his mother's joy. He, born a soldier, loved the camp, of future prowess bore the stamp, while clinging yet to mother's hand, had all the air of high command. The 13th treads to muffled drum, to someone in its ranks has come. The soldier's fate to someone small is seen by hearse and little Paul, who lies so bravely neath the stars that wraps a form too young for wars. Our Sergeant Willie, Sherman's boy, his father's pride, his mother's joy. Battalion, halt! Battalion, weep! Your dearest comrade sleeps the sleep that knows no waking. Dry your tears. The brave have even in death no fears. Whate'er was mortal, free from guilt, resists in the tomb affection built. His soul has joined the ranks above and found a heavenly father's love. Poem by George Morton. With military promptitude, the following characteristic letter of acknowledgement was duly sent, dated September the 9th, 1889. G. H. McCabe, Esquire, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. My dear sir, please accept for yourself the sender, and for Mr. Morton, the author of the poem, Sergeant Willie, a copy of which is just received, my heartfelt and grateful thanks. The same, I assure you, will be preserved in my archives, together with many other encomiums, mainly from the hands of members of the old 13th, to which regiment he was in life so thoroughly devoted. Very truly yours, W. T. Sherman, General. The General's habits of life were simple. He had a keen sense of the beauty of nature, and never was happier than when his camp was pitched in some forest of lofty pines, where the wind sang through the treetops in melodious measure, and the feet were buried in the soft carpeting of spindles. He was the last one to complain when the table fare was reduced to beef and hard tack, and, in truth, he rather enjoyed poverty of food as one of the conditions of a soldier's life. He apologized to his guest, the Secretary of War, one day at Savannah because certain luxuries, such as canned fruits and jellies, had found their way to his table. This, he remarked, is the consequence of coming into houses and cities. The only place to live, Mr. Secretary, is out of doors in the woods. This simplicity of taste, which was so perfectly natural to the general, served well in the campaigns of the war. It is easily seen that in making long marches, the most fatal clog to successful operations is excessive transportation, and the tendency of the army was constantly to accretion. But Sherman reduced baggage trains to the minimum, and himself shared the privations of the common soldier. Unselfish patriotism. General Sherman's patriotism was a vital force. He gave himself and all that he had to the national cause. Personal considerations never influenced him. Doubtless he was ambitious, but it was impossible to discern any selfish or unworthy motive either in his words or deeds. We do not believe it possible for a man more absolutely to subordinate himself and his personal interests than he did. His patriotism was as pure as the faith of a child, and before it family and social influences were powerless. His relatives were the last persons to receive from his hand preferment or promotion. In answer to the request of one nearly allied to him that he would give his son a position on his staff, the general's reply was curt and unmistakable. Let him enter the ranks as a soldier and carry a musket a few years. In all of his pleasant and peaceful old age, General Sherman realized fully the necessary infirmities of increasing years and the probability that death might remove him at any time. The contemplation of death had no terrors for him. His position in this matter is best expressed in the reply which he made on his 70th birthday to a conventional wish that he might have many happy returns of the day. He said, then, with a full appreciation of the insecurity of life, as well as of the fact that his race was nearly run, I am too old to hope for many returns of the day, and then life is so uncertain. Death seems to come nowadays almost without any warning, but many a man has sprung up in readiness when I have had the trumpet sounded and I am still a soldier. When Gabriel sounds his trumpet, I shall be ready. He was, of course, long past the years when a man can expect vigorous health, and he often spoke about death, and said he did not expect to be much longer on the scene of active affairs. He frequently prefaced remarks about the future by saying, "If I live," and "If I am here." Indeed, for a number of years, especially since the death of his wife, his mind assumed a melancholy mood. The deaths of Hancock, Sheridan, and Grant, with whom he was intimately associated, were to him profound shocks, and had an effect different to the philosophical way in which they were regarded by others. For some time his hearing had been failing, and he had become quite deaf. This troubled him very much, as his senses had been phenomenally keen. It pained him when he could no longer hear the birds sing in the spring, or the sparrows twittering in the city, and friends had to be exceedingly careful not to talk before him about things he could not hear. If such a thing occurred, he was likely to get up and leave the room. A poem, The Greatest Soldier. How should the greatest soldier die? The winds and seas and hills reply. At peace, the horrid front of war, smoothed by a smile from every scar, his sword and spear beat into hooks, to prune his vines among his books. His armor rusting on the wall, friends thicker than the leaves that fall, in Vallombrosa, with a sigh of sweet content, thus let him die. Where should the greatest soldier lie? The winds and seas and hills reply, no granite base nor marble pile, nor fretted arch nor vaulted aisle, nor storied urn nor sculptured stone is worthy now that he is gone. In every heart where freedom swells, in every soul where honor dwells, till children in their turn impart each memory of soul and heart, to others who still love to hear the name of him whom all hold dear, there of the nations loved possessed, in peace and honor let him rest. Here ends Book One.